Welcome, everyone. We are so pleased to be hosting our third and final Writers Here and Now event of this semester, featuring the incomparable Roseanne A. Brown. What a terrific honor and pleasure it is for me to be here welcoming you all. When I say here, what I mean is this: the Jimenez Porter Writers House and the Creative Writing Program and the English Department acknowledge that we are on the ancestral lands of the Piscataway people, who were among the first in the Western Hemisphere. This indigenous land was stolen from the Piscataway people by European colonists. We make this acknowledgement out of respect to our Piscataway elders and ancestors, past and present. Please take a moment of silence to consider the many legacies of violence, displacement, migration, and settlement that bring us together here at the University of Maryland. The Jimenez Porter Writers House and the Creative Writing Program would also like to thank our sponsors who continue to support our series: the Department of English, the Center for Literary and Comparative Studies, particularly Tita Chico and Karen Nelson, the College of Arts and Humanities, Book Lab, alumnus John Dvorak, and finally, Professor of Electrical Engineering, Robert Newcomb. And now I'd like to introduce Jackie Muick, our graduate student extraordinaire at the Writers House. Jackie has spearheaded all of the administrative aspects of this event, and we would certainly not be here today enjoying this reading without all of her time, hard work, her know-how, and her perseverance in figuring things out and following them through. Thank you so much, Jackie. Jackie will introduce Rosie and will also be moderating the Q&A after the reading. Jackie?
Hello. Hi, I'm Jackie Muick. I'm a graduate student at Maryland and the graduate assistant at the Jimenez Porter Writers House. I've known Rosie since freshman year of my undergrad, when we were both students at the Writers House. She was my RA and she played an integral role to my experience as an undergrad in the Writers House itself. From teaching in Japan to publishing her first novel in a pandemic to getting to join the Rick Riordan imprint, she has so many other projects, and I have spent the entire semester looking forward to her visit and just gushing about her to anyone who would listen to me. Roseanne Rosie A. Brown was born in Kumasi, Ghana, and immigrated to the wild jungles of central Maryland as a child. Writing was her first love, and she knew from a young age that she wanted to use the power of writing, creative and otherwise, to connect to the different cultures she called home. She graduated from the University of Maryland with a bachelor's in journalism and is also a teaching assistant for the school's Jimenez Porter Writers House program. Her journalistic work has been featured by Voice of America, among other outlets. Her debut novel, A Song of Wraiths in Ruin, was an instant New York Times bestseller. She currently lives outside of Washington, D.C., where in her free time, she can usually be found wandering the woods, making memes, or thinking about Star Wars, or tweeting some hilarious, hilarious tweets. Rosie is represented by Caressa Robinson of Nelson Literary Agency. To the Writers House, Rosie Brown is the queen of Huggy Bear, a wonderfully chaotic game of furiously hugging other people, and the only four-year resident of our home in Queen Anne's Hall. She has brought so much joy and light into Writers House that it is hard to explain. We remember her smile every time we see her, in the dorms, in class, and everywhere else. The Writers House staff remember her applying to teach in Japan while she was working on the initial drafts of what became A Song of Wraiths in Ruin. For me, Rosie was one of the people at the heart of my experience in undergrad at Writers House. She played a larger role in my freshman year than she thinks she did, like making cute little dinosaur cutouts to go on our walls, which is still on my door at my parents' house. Her book, A Song of Wraiths and Ruin, came for me and many others at a place in the pandemic as a reminder that there is still joy and light in this world, and gives me hope to go forward, and gives me hope that I'm going to be able to find the same escape in her second novel when it comes out next year. So Without any more words from me, we are so incredibly excited to welcome our very own Roseanne Brown to this month's Writers Here and Now. Rosie?
Jonna, Jackie, thank you so much for those wonderful introductions. I still cannot believe you have your like door. I just remember like staying up till 4 a.m. making those and being like, they're just gonna throw them out. So knowing you still have yours, just like that has just made my entire night. So excited to be here with you all. Writer's House was like, I tell people Writer's House was the best part of undergrad for me and like the heart of being in college and like where I found so many of my people, where I found like my best friends to this day, where I like developed my creative voice and like who I want to be as a creative and a writer. I just met so many wonderful people, Jonna, Vivian, Jackie, still in contact with them. So I'm so, so excited to be here. And so we're gonna start. I'm gonna read you guys a chapter from A Song, Wraiths, and Ruin, and then we'll be having questions. Like Jackie said, Levan and I'm in the Q&A. And so, I guess to get started, just to give a bit of back, let me just start for those of you who might not have read it yet. A Song, Wraiths, and Ruin takes place in a world inspired by West African folklore, and it follows two protagonists, a refugee named Malik and a princess named Karina. So when Malik's younger sister is kidnapped by a vengeful spirit, he strikes a deal that in order to win her freedom, he must kill Karina, the crown princess of Zaran. However, what he doesn't know is that Karina's mother has just been assassinated, and she's discovered a forbidden spell that will bring her back to life. So she starts, however, to do the spell, she has to murder her husband, and she doesn't have a husband. So she sets up this marriage competition to find some dude, kill him, and bring her mom back to life. Meanwhile, Malik enters the competition, attempting to get close to Karina, win, and then kill her. So he's trying to kill her, she's trying to kill him, and neither of them are aware of this. And the book is about the way everything kind of goes off the rails when they actually meet each other and realize they have a lot more in common than they thought. And after the reading, I'll talk a lot more about my inspiration, what it kind of means, like writing from my African background. But yes, to give some context for this chapter, this is a Malik chapter. The book is told in two dual POV. So we see both Malik and Karina's sides of the story. And this is a Malik chapter that takes place right after his younger sister Nadia has been kidnapped. Okay. Chapter 7, Malik. As Malik stared at Gigi's limp form on the ground before him, a single thought ran through his head. They'd been wrong. Everyone he knew had been wrong. It had begun when he was 6 years old, and he and his grandmother had gone to visit Nana Titi, an old woman in their village who had caught the river flu. He'd been playing in the garden outside her hut while the adults talked with somber voices inside. And the flower spirits living in her bushes had told him the old woman wouldn't see the next sunrise. When he had helpfully relayed the information to her family, they brushed off his claims as childish grief. Nana Titi had been dead by morning. After that had come the screaming. Screaming from Nana Titi's family at his, screaming from his family at him, screaming from panicked villagers as a rumor spread that Malik had used sorcery to end the old woman's life. Him screaming as the elders tried to chase the demon out of him, whipping his feet until they bled and forcing him to drink concoctions he couldn't stomach. Screaming again when he returned home, only to find the hallucinations. He knew now they were hallucinations. They always had been. Everyone said they were. Hadn't gone away, and he was still as broken as he'd ever been. All of them, the elders, the other villagers, even his home family, had told Malik that spirits didn't exist. He had let them tell him that he was crazy, that he was ill, that he was cursed. He had listened when they said that all he had to do was try a little harder, just be a little less of what he was to make everything easier for everyone. He had trusted them, and they had been wrong. It was this single thought that resounded through Malik's mind as Adir's shadows cleared around him. There were no signs of Nyeni, Adir, or the grim folk anywhere. Nothing but the empty eyes of the masks gazing down at them. Malik bit down a hysterical laugh. Of course, now that he had proof that the lie that had shaped his childhood was just that, the grim folk would choose to leave him alone. He took her. He just took her, Layla said, as if repeating the words might make them less true. Malik had held Nadia in his arms, and that thing, no, Adir, had ripped her away like she wasn't the baby he used to rock to sleep every night or teach how to walk, like she was just some doll to be thrown around on a whim. This can't, no! Layla tore the nearest mask off the wall, searching beneath it. She ran her hands over every crack and even fell to her hands and knees, inspecting the lines in the floor. Is there a trap door here somewhere? Some kind of, I don't know, lever? People don't just disappear into thin air. If Malik had been able to form words, he would have reminded his sister that they weren't dealing with people. People couldn't possess animals the size of houses or control shadows like puppeteers. A shiver ran down Malik's spine. He had never told a deer his name, yet the Obelstone had known it anyway. How long had the spirit been watching them? What else did he know? As Layla continued her frantic search of the house, Malik crawled over to Gigi and gently brought the toy to his chest. Medea never went anywhere without it. Whether she was playing, eating, or even sleeping, Gigi was always curled lovingly in her arms or stuffed down the front of her shirt. He had to get the toy back to her, or else she wouldn't be able to sleep tonight. And that was when the tears began. Without his satchel strap to hold on to, Malik clutched at the front of his already tattered tunic, his body shaking. He heaved, but nothing came out. It had been days since his last meal, and nothing, not even bile, remained in his stomach. This was all his fault. If only he hadn't followed that griot. If only he hadn't helped that boy. If only he had listened to everyone when they told him to keep his head down and his mouth shut. Malik was the one who deserved to rot as a deer's captive, not Nadia. With no one else to turn to, he prayed to Aranko, to the Great Mother, to every deity that had ever existed and ever would, to spare Nadia. He would have taken death 1,000 times over if it meant his sister could live. If the gods heard him, they didn't respond. So many questions crowded within Malik. If the grim folk were real, did that mean the gods were too? Adir clearly had some kind of history with Bahia Alahari. What had he done to make her trap him for 1,000 years? If Adir wanted revenge against her entire line, why did he want Princess Karina dead and not the Sultana as well? And of the millions of people who lived in Sonande, why did Adir think he could kill Princess Karina? Could he kill Princess Karina? As Malik's head swam, the mark scurried over his chest to settle on his left arm. The feeling was akin to oil running over his skin, and the sensation sent another wave of revulsion coursing through him. It was all too easy to imagine the heat of the mark growing into a blazing inferno, one that would burn through his chest if he dared speak of what had transpired that night. A deer had called its weapon form a spirit blade, another phrase Malik had never heard. His free hand twitched to claw away the taint a deer had left on his body, but he squeezed Gigi instead. Even if the mark felt like a violation of all his boundaries, he couldn't risk damaging it, not when it would be the key to killing the princess. Yet beneath the terror and exhaustion and disgust, the tendrils of a force Malik had never had a name for pulsed within him. The same force had drawn him to Nani's call that afternoon, and that had bonded itself to a deer during the blood oath. Magic. That was what the spirit had called the restless thing inside Malik. The realization spread through his body, filling in cracks he hadn't even known were there. He'd never been crazy. He'd been right. Head spinning and throat burning, Malik looked up to see Layla standing in front of him. We have to... Her voice cracked. She closed her eyes and took a deep breath. We have to get out of here. We don't know how safe this place is. But what if Nadia comes looking for us? If their sister somehow managed to escape from Nadia, or the Obosome changed his mind and let her go, they were best off waiting for her there. We both know that isn't going to happen. Layla reached for Malik, but he jerked away. Suddenly, they were children again, fighting each other for no other reason than because they could. Malik didn't understand how Layla could be so calm about this, so heartless. Just because she could push her emotions aside and never feel anything didn't mean he could. We have to leave now, just a little longer, Malik cried. She could come back. A chill ran down his spine, followed by a high-pitched keening in his ears. Heavy footfalls pounded toward the house. We sense a disturbance coming from the street, said a deep voice. Malik and Layla both froze. Soldiers. Layla recovered first, hauling Malik to his feet. This time, he didn't fight as she tugged him through a dilapidated door leading out of the kitchen. As they burst into the street, they were engulfed in a flood of light. Bahia's comet blazed in the western corner of the sky with the intensity of a small sun, so bright that Malik could not gaze directly at it without squinting. The comet seemed bone white at first glance, but further appraisal revealed trails of purple, blue, and green wisping off the comet's tail and disappearing into the star-studded night. Everyone in the street had their faces turned heavenward, light dancing across their bodies in waves. In that moment, every person in Zaran was connected by something that had existed for eons before any of them had been born. And Malik felt the urge to cry once more that Nadia wasn't there to see it. He was going to free her. He swore in the name of the Great Mother and the comet soaring overhead. But how? It wasn't until Malik's eyes adjusted to the brightness that he realized they weren't in the neighborhood they had entered the house from. Unlike the street before, this one seemed opulent, with flowering gardens and strong walls on all sides. A house that could disappear and reappear wherever it wished to be was the least strange thing that had happened that day, yet Malik was still shocked. He angled himself toward the glittering outline of Kasar Alahari. Surely Princess Karina was there right now doing whatever it was princesses did while other people suffered. The mark scurried to his palm and switched into its blade form, heavy and waiting. "Where are you going?" demanded Layla, wrapping her hand around Malik's arm as he stepped away. "I have to find the princess." Kasar Alahari was so close. If he left now, he'd surely arrive by dawn. "So you're just going to walk up to the palace with a knife in your hands? The guards will skewer you with arrows before you even reach the gates." "But I have to do something." "You won't be doing anything if you get yourself killed." Layla dragged Malik into a side alley where they crouched behind a pile of firewood. Options. What are our options?" "Go to Kasar Alahari," he suggested. "No one just goes to Kasar Alahari, Malik." "Fine. Poison." "How are you going to poison her if you can't get into the palace to begin with?" snapped Layla. And Malik fought the urge to ask if she had a plan or if she was just going to keep shooting down his. "Maybe I could ambush her at the opening ceremony, but there will be people everywhere. How would you pull it off without getting caught?" The spear blade sank into his skin and Malik put his head in his hands. There was an answer here. There had to be. Idir wouldn't waste his time asking for a task Malik couldn't accomplish. Would he? A crowd of purple-clad people passed by the alley and Malik glanced at their palm. They were all lifelined, same as him. This must be the life portion of Temple Way, which meant that people were heading to the choosing ceremony. Even now, as Malik's world crumbled to ash, the people of Zaran were finding out who would get the honor of fighting for the alliance and living at Kasar Alahari for the next week. Malik bolted upright. The champions would be housed at Kasar Alahari for the duration of Solstagia. They'd be living with Princess Karina. Malik's eyes traced the familiar lines of the lifelined emblem etched into his palm. The role of champion was so sacred among the Zarani that not even the Sultana could revoke the title once given. If he became a champion, he'd be living within a stone throw of Princess Karina for the rest of Solstagia. Nothing else would get him so close to the princess so quickly. And once he was near Princess Karina, it would be easy to find an opportunity to summon his spear blade and let the weapon do what it had been created to do. Malik shook his head. No, this was absurd. There was no way he would ever be named a champion, not when there were thousands of people in Zaran more suited to the task, and no Eshrans had been chosen for hundreds of years. Yet what other choice did he have? Malik thought and thought, and no other path seemed as clear as this one. Somehow, he had to get Life Priestess to choose him as a champion. But before that, he needed to get to Life Temple. "Where are we going?" yelled Layla as Malik tugged her out of the alley. It was an odd feeling, him leading and her following for once. "Just trust me." Malik and Layla slipped into the crowd, and if people noticed that Layla was not life-aligned, they seemed too excited to mind. His sister's vice grip on his arm didn't lessen as they followed the masses into the plaza before Life Temple. Images of Adanko adorned every altar and doorstep, and her haunting eyes seemed to bore into Malik, as if she already knew and disapproved of the small plan growing in his mind. A rustling sound came from overhead. The Grimfolk had returned. Not in ones or twos, but dozens upon dozens, more than Malik had ever seen together at one time. They paraded through the sky in a procession to match the one below. And for once, Malik was too awed to be scared. Legends had told of people coming into abnormal abilities after contact with the supernatural. Had meeting Adir strengthened his ability to see the Grimfolk? "Do you see that?" he asked Layla, buoyed by an unlikely hope that died when she said, "See what?" Disappointment left a bitter taste in his mouth. If only there were some way to show his sister exactly how much magic surrounded them at all times, let her glimpse the world the way he saw it. At this thought, his powers twisted within him, drowning out his other senses. It was an itch that demanded release, but Malik did not know how to relieve the burn. He flexed and unflexed his fingers, willing something to happen. Nothing did. They reached the Life Temple all too soon. The Life Pavilion had been modeled after the spiral that symbolized their alignment, and it was in this spiral pattern that the crowd stood. A stone statue of Aranko towered over everyone, her long ears turned toward Bahia's comet. The ceremony was already well underway, with thousands of voices singing together in a tune Malik knew well. It was the same one the Lifeline sang during weekly temple services, and the familiarity of the melody was welcome after the horrors of Malik's day. On the dais in front of the temple, Life Priestess stepped forward, her bowed head shaved and body swathed in robes of deep purple. A large white hair was draped across her shoulders like a shawl and peered curiously at the audience. Life Priestess threw her head back and raised her hands to the sky. Oh, blessed Aranko, you born of life and patron of all those who walk the path of the living and the righteous, honored are we to gather tonight in your holy presence. Dearest patron, bless us with your wisdom so that we may choose the champion who can best show the world your glory and usher us into a new era. The chorus grew loud as a tsunami, and Life Priestess began to dance in time to the song, weaving in and out of the plumes of smoke that rose from the base of Aranko's statue. Speak to me, my patron. Reveal to me the champion you have chosen. Malik's locked eyes with the goddess's stone facade, a priestess could be convinced and needled, bribed and negotiated with, but no one could force her choice for champion. No one except the goddess herself. If becoming a champion was the only way to get close to Princess Karina, then Malik would make himself a champion. The magic Malik had spent so long denying climbed to the surface, burning through every inch of his being. He clapped a hand over his mouth as tears streamed unbidden down his face. After so many years of pushing his magic down into the darkest parts of himself, Malik didn't know what to do now that it lay within his grasp. Malik, what's the matter? Layla crouched beside him. What's wrong? It's me, Malik whispered, and even as the ceremony raged on, the air around him seemed to grow thicker, more real. What? Asked Layla. It's me. The champion. Aranko is going to choose me, he said. The same ethereal blue light that had bathed Nani and Adir now bathed Malik, though no one but him could see it. Speak to me, Aranko. Speak to me, called Life Priestess, her voice buoyed by the crowd surrounding her. It's me. The champion is me. Aranko has chosen me as her champion. Layla watched in shock as Malik's body twitched, fighting down the influx of magic racing beneath his skin. He'd been taught to fold it away inside himself, and now the person the world had beaten out of him was further away than he had ever been. As Life Priestess's voice crescendoed to a graceful song above his head, Malik clutched the front of his tunic and screamed. In that single moment, Malik forgot about Solstagia. He forgot about Adir and the Grimfolk and even Nadia. The only person in Malik's mind was himself, or rather the child he had been in a memory long forgotten, sitting alone at the top of a lemon tree and staring down at an impossibly vast world below as he created illusion after illusion to make himself feel less alone. The magic had never abandoned him. It had been his from birth, a companion he'd had back before he'd even known to call it that. And he was done letting the world deny him what had always been his. His voice unusually calm, Malik said one last time, Aranko has chosen me as her champion. The cheering turned to gasps. A white apparition rose from inside the Aranko statue, nebulous as a wisp of smoke. The creature twisted, sprouting long ears and a graceful arching back until its resemblance was identical to the hair statue on which it stood. Elegant markings ringed its unearthly white skin, markings only associated with one being, Aranko, the goddess of life. Every person in the pavilion fell to their knees except for Malik. Because where everyone else saw a deity, all Malik could feel was his own magic radiating outward from the creature, a tether linking them both. The illusion leaped from the statue and raced through the air toward him. On instinct, Malik's arms flew to cover his face, but the image of Aranko circled him once, twice, three times, her ghostly paws leaving a bright trail in her wake. And then she was gone. As quickly as she had appeared, Malik lowered his hands, his knees buckling beneath him. The magic in him died down and the mark's frantic movement slowed. Layla stared at him as if she were seeing him for the very first time. What did you just do? She whispered. Silence, heavier than any sound Malik had ever known, filled the pavilion. Then Life Priestess spoke, her voice undulating with awe. Our goddess has chosen her champion. Our goddess has chosen her champion. Our goddess has chosen her champion. Malik didn't fight when the people hauled him onto their shoulders and carried him over to Life Priestess, Layla struggling to keep up. They deposited him next to the woman, who lifted Malik's arm above his head and displayed the lifeline emblem on his palm for all to see. My siblings, Adanko herself has blessed us tonight. Raise your voice and thanks to our goddess and show your love to the newest life champion of Solstaja. The roar that followed next was the loudest yet and would be heard all across the city, all the way to Kasar Alahari and beyond. Malik stared at what felt like the entire world cheering his way. He had done it. He had spoken an illusion of Adanko into existence and had chosen him as her champion. His magic had come when he had called, as if they'd never been forced apart at all. And now he was going to use it to kill Princess Karina and save Nadia, even if he had to lie to every single person Zoran to do so.
Oh. Yes, Rosie. Yes, that was outstanding. Oh, Malik using his magic gave me, like, I was like reading it and it gave me chills the first time. I was like, yes. Lost my mind just a little bit. Very exciting. So thank you so much for reading that chapter. We're now going to transition to the Q&A section. So all of you guys in attendance are welcome and encouraged to drop any questions you have for Rosie in the Q&A box. It should be a button at the bottom of your screen if you have not been in a Zoom style call like this one. Outstanding. So Rosie, I believe you had some stuff you wanted to talk about, like your inspiration and what it was like writing about, like writing a novel that is inspired by West African folklore.
Sure. So the idea for Wraiths actually came back when I was a student at UMD. It was back my junior year. It would have been spring 2016. And I'd actually tried to write a novel several times before that, but I just, every time I'd get to like the 25,000 word mark, I'd be like, this is boring. I hate this. And I'd give up. And so I think what kind of made this idea stick out to me is I distinctly remember, so one of the big themes in the book is sort of mental health. We see that in the chapter I just read a little bit, Malik kind of dealing with how the members of his village, members of families, they didn't really understand how to kind of deal with his anxiety, with his panics, and how it sort of made his magic worse and made him more of a pariah, right? And so writing a book that sort of featured mental health in that way was really important to me, because that's something I've dealt with my own life. And I distinctly remember it was like spring 2016. I'm walking back from the counseling center at UMD and looking back at like everything I talked about with my therapist and all that. And I was thinking to myself, if a ghost tried to possess me right now, they'd be like, you have a lot going in there. Like, I don't want this. Like, you can have this back. Like, I don't like that. And like, it sounds funny, but I got this idea like, wait, what would happen to a character this actually happened to? And it got me thinking, I had never seen mental illness, especially in a fantasy setting where it was not used as like, it was always either a metaphor. Like, it's like, oh, they have magic powers because they're depressed. Or it was villainized. Like, we see a lot with Disney villains. They do this a lot. They have varied traits that are like associated with lots of different like mental illnesses, different disorders. But I was like, I wanted a book where the character with mental illness, it was, they're still the hero. It's not something villainized. It's not something glorified. It's the reality he deals with. And it's, the magic's not a metaphor. It's like, he deals with literal magic and he deals with literal panic attacks. They're both very literal. They both sort of inform the other, but one does not like negate the other. And so Malik was the character who came to my mind from there, and it kind of grew from there. And then Karina became the other character. I need a counterpoint to his voice because there was so much happening in this world. I knew from the start I wanted a very big sprawling world, something sort of very epic in scope. And there was just so much happening that Malik could not be there for, so I sort of needed Karina as a counterbalance to that. And as for how I ended up setting it in West Africa, my family's from Ghana. I was born there, like you mentioned. And so my first sort of foray into fantasy was actually through storytelling, through the idea of like oral storytelling and Nansi tales and like the different sort of epics I heard growing up, especially because like sort of the fantasy tradition we see in a lot of different African cultures doesn't exactly look like the fantasy tradition in the way we see it in the West. And I wanted to write a like epic fantasy novel that drew from that sort of tradition and that drew from fantasy the way I had been grown to understand fantasy. That might be slightly different than people's ideas of grab a wand and point it and chant some words and stuff happens. So that's kind of where the book came from.
Yeah, and in addition to that, you also you divide magic up into these two kind of groups. You have the Olraji and the Zawenji. Probably mispronounced that. My sincerest apologies. But I think it's also really interesting that, like, one is considered more of a kind of a good, for lack of a better term, kind of magic, and the other one is seen as kind of more malicious in its intent. And that you also have Malik as someone who can use the one that's considered malicious in that distinction. I think that's really interesting that you also, like, yes, he's dealing with all of these things, but he's also using a kind of magic that historically in this world has not been used for good. Yeah. I think, and with mental illness, I think it's everybody's favorite line in this book that comes from the end. And I'm not going to say too much about the rest of it, but the line is, "This is my mind. I am the strongest person here." And I felt like you were able to tackle mental illness really, really well, and like kind of give that justification and that kind of ability that, like, you're not weak, you are strong.
Thank you. I'm just seeing the way people like kind of really relate to that line and really relate to Malik, especially because, like, in a lot of ways, especially within YA, we're kind of like, there's kind of this idea of what a YA hero has to look like. You all know your Edward Cullens, you know, like Peeta, Gale, your Harry Potters, all those dudes. And like this idea that like a YA hero, he's like broody, he's like tough, he punches people and all this. And like Malik is very much intentionally the antithesis of that. Malik is very scared, he's very anxious. Malik does not like doing things. His powers don't come from his physicality or his combat or any of that, but like from his ability to connect to people, to understand them, to kind of work their way into their heads. A lot of sort of traits that are, like you mentioned, are traits that are honestly often associated with villains, but also associated with like female characters. We tend to see female characters being the ones who tend to use more sort of mental warfare, like think Cersei Lannister in Game of Thrones, like kind of the ones who kind of play the court game rather than like they're running into the battlefield. And so with Malik, that was very intentional. Like I wanted to take this character in this world where he'd very much be rewarded for toxic masculinity and more like the sort of aggressive stereotype, like this is how a hero is supposed to act and all this. And his skill set and his like abilities are very much the opposite of that, and find ways for him to still succeed with that. And so at first I was a little bit nervous, like, oh, our YA readers, are they gonna like Malik? He's so different from what we're used to. Like, are they gonna think he's whiny, or you're like, why don't you just punch some people? But like, I've been very pleased with the reception. A lot of people really said like, wow, I wish I got to see like a male character like this growing up, because I always felt like if you're a dude, you have to be so strong and tough and ready to fight. And like, Malik vanquishes his enemies, and like he doesn't have to lift a finger to do it. So I think that's really great, like seeing how people have come around this character.
Yeah, and so we have a few questions in the chat about your dual POV as well, and I think it's a great kind of segue, because on the flip side of that, we have Karina, who is more than happy to do whatever it takes physically and is just kind of charging ahead and doing anything she can to like perform the spell and bring back her mother. So I'm also very curious, along with everyone in the Q&A box right now, about how did that come about and how did that change how you were writing this? Because I know you didn't start out with this novel as a dual perspective.
Definitely. So at first I started just Malik, and I just realized there's too much happening, and like I just could not have him everywhere at once. So I was like, okay, so there's other stuff the reader needs to know. How do I get it? And I kind of cycled through a bunch of characters whose POV, for a while, I considered just having Malik as the main, maybe having just a couple interstitial characters, chapters from other characters, just to kind of see what's happening. But I was like, no, I think we need another set narrative, especially because one of the big themes as I was writing was the idea that the truth, two people can see the same truth and both be right and both be wrong. And so I was like, okay then, so if Malik has this viewpoint, Malik's at the bottom of society, he is a refugee, he's from this sort of like oppressed minority, then how then is somebody else at the opposite side going to view this? How are they going to move through the world? How then? And I realized the princess he's trying to kill, Karina, she is the one at the opposite end of that. She is like the second, or honestly the most privileged person in their society. She has access to everything he's never had access to. Like, she has been taught a very different myth and legend of the world than he has. And she is the one who's going to have all the viewpoints that are going to challenge the way he sees the world. So it's very intentional that Malik will say X is true, and then Karina will actually say, actually Y is true. And it's kind of the reader's place to kind of figure out, are they right? Are they wrong? Are they both right? Are they both wrong? And so I was like, okay, so Karina's our other viewpoint. But then when I started her character, honestly, at first when I started Karina, she actually started out very sort of like very sweet, very, I was really thinking Disney princess at first. And this was very intentional again, because like, obviously as a Black woman writer, I'm very aware of the stereotypes Black female characters get in fiction. And the idea of loud, aggressive, always sexually promiscuous, like the sassy, independent Black woman, all that stupid shit. And I was like, I want to write a character who is the opposite of that. She's sweet, she's gentle, she's like literally like Disney princess, she's like so soft, all this, because like that's what I want to read growing up. Like I want to read about soft Black girls being like loved and like cherished, and like they get to be the damsel in distress because they deserve to be saved. But Karina kept not coming out like this. And at first I was worried, I'm like, wait a minute, am I writing the stereotype? Like, do I only know how to write like aggressive Black girls? Hang on, am I the problem? And it was actually a very big sort of like thing for me. I was really worried because I'm so aware of how the stereotype hurts young Black people, how it hurt me. But then I took a step back. I'm like, okay, there's a reason this character keeps coming out as aggressive, and she keeps coming out on the page as like someone who will like shove herself in people's face. And honestly, she's mean. Like she's, like Karina would bully me 100% if we were in the same like class growing up. Like she's a very mean person. And I was like, it got me thinking, I'm like, and especially as a Black girl growing up, this idea that even when I was justifiably angry, even when like I'm in a situation where the other party has objectively done something to harm me, my anger was always seen as something that was wrong and it's something I can't utilize. This idea that the stereotype, because I didn't want to be labeled the angry Black girl, I couldn't own up to this. This is something I'm not allowed to access. And I started realizing, I want her to be angry. I want her to be mean. I want her to be aggressive. And then I want the reader to stop and think, wait, she's not just aggressive because that's just how she is. I want them to look at her world and how the things that have happened to her has affected how she's ended up like this. And this idea, it really get them thinking, oh, how many times do we see a person, we just assume, oh, they're just like this. And we don't take that deeper level of, be, why are they like this? What has caused this? What societal ills? Especially because on the surface, Karina seems so privileged, and then you sort of break down her role in the society, what she's actually been through, her traumas, and you start to realize in a lot of ways she's just as trapped as Malik is, even though like materially she's better off than he is. So Karina then became a situation for these characters who seem so opposite, and realizing how they're actually very similar, and how that comes down to the way sort of the society has sort of stifled them both, and how they learn to break past that.
Yeah. Oh, I love both of them. I like even when Karina is like being a little bit mean, I'm like, it's okay. I love you anyway. I just connected to her instantly. I was all on board. We've had quite a few questions about your revision process and kind of what was that like. You're writing the sequel in a pandemic, and writing already is isolating. You have to be by yourself to an extent, and you're not writing in a vacuum, but you are writing in a vacuum, and the pandemic kind of enhances that. So how has that been for you lately and before, in the before times?
Okay, so that's like, there's two parts to this answer. So the first part is to understand sort of the timeline of Wraiths. So I get the idea, spring 2016. I finished the first draft like January 5th, 2017. I remember the exact date because the date Nicki Minaj and Meek Mill broke up. That was very important to me. So January 5th, 2017, I finished the first draft. And I'm sitting there like, what the hell do I do now? Because I had no idea what you actually did once you finished the manuscript, because I'd never finished a manuscript. And I was interning for Entangle Publishing at the time, and one of my bosses there, and Ashley Hearn, she's like, oh my god, have you heard of this contest, Pitch Wars? It matches up like aspiring writers with like published professionals. They'll help you revise your book, and then you put in front of agents, like, you should totally submit this. This is so cool. I'm like, cool, never heard of that, but why not? So I spent the summer of 2017 on draft 2, preparing my book to submit to Pitch Wars. Submit to Pitch Wars July 2017. I get accepted August 2017. And then from like end of August to like November, I work on draft 3 with my mentor, who was just like, oh wow, you have lots of great ideas here, I need you to rewrite everything. And I was like, okay. And I think the most important thing I learned during that time period was this idea that like, you have to really, basically this idea that nothing is sacred except the stuff that's sacred. And I know that sounds so vague, but like just the idea that you have to be willing to rip apart everything about your book, as long as you understand the core heart of what is like the core, what's beating at the center of it. Because the thing is, Wraiths has went through 6 rewrites across its 4-year history. I'll detail the other 3 in a second, but the core of the book never changed. So draft 3 was with my mentor for the contest. in November, we had the Age of Soul case, and that's when I signed with Curisa, my agent. And then she's like, okay, I just want you to do a couple more edits before we go to submit to editors. So yeah, even after you get your agent, you still have to do edits. Like, there's a lot of people who think once you have the agent, you're done. No. So she's like, I have a couple more changes and stuff I think that'll make this, like, editors really want to look at it. And I was like, okay, Curisa. So I did that from February through, like, March of 2018. So this is draft four now. And then, so draft four gets submitted to editors at the various houses. And my editor, Kristen, at Bowser and Bray, HarperCollins, they're the imprint that did The Hate U Give. She picks it up. She's like, oh, I love this. Yeah, blah, blah, blah. She buys it. Yay, love that. And she's like, so I have some more changes for you. And just to fast track it from there, what sold was draft four of the book, and the version, like in the printed version you're holding, is draft 10. So even after selling, I still did six more drafts with my editor. Like, not all of them were full, like starting over rewrite, but like each one was like, okay, we need to target this time, or we need to fix this, or like, let's tighten the characters, or like, let's cut the dialogue. Like, and each time, there's always this feeling you're making the book worse. Like, no matter what, like when you're in the middle of a revision, you're like, there is no way this is better than the last version. Like, this just can't be done. And then every time when you're done and you step back, you're like, oh wait, that actually is better. You're right. And there's very much this idea that an editor comes in and is like, you suck. But like, it's never been like that. Like, just from the start, it was always very clear. Like, Kristen saw what I was trying to do and what the book could be. And she was always about, you, what you have is solid, but how do we get this to be the best version of what it could possibly be? And so it took a lot of stamina, I'm not gonna lie. Like, sometimes I barely remember that time period, because I just remember going and going and going, like, this character's still not working, this plot's still not working, this doesn't make sense. But like, it's very invigorating, because I think there's no better teacher for writing than to just do it, and having to do it again and again and again and again taught me a lot, and gave me a better idea of sort of like, I have a better idea now of when I'm starting something and I just know it's not going to work from the jump, versus when I didn't really know, I'm just like, let me just try this. Who knows? But I can save myself a little bit of heartbreak. Like, no, we tried that before. It did not work. We are not doing that again. So as to how the sort of my process has changed with the pandemic, the biggest issue has actually not been kind of like how I do it, but just more like where, because I'm someone who works best outside of my home. Like, home is a relaxed space. I do not come here to work. So the fact that we can only work at home has very been the biggest struggle, like forcing myself to actually get up and write. Like, when I was in Japan, I used to go, I'd get up before work, I'd write for an hour before work, I'd go to work, come home, nap, eat, go to the local like cafe, and I'd write for like seven more hours there. But like, I didn't write at home, because like, when I'm at home, I am knocked out. So that's been the biggest thing, like really trying to get into that work mentality when like, I have to also be in the place that I associate with not doing the thing I'm supposed to be doing. So that's been the biggest problem. Right now, Wraiths 2 is another big problem has been the fact that I'm just in such a different place, like obviously life-wise and mentally, oh, yep, that's the cover. Life-wise and mentally than I was when I first wrote Wraiths 1, right? And so there's this idea like, oh, I know this book inside out. Going back to it's going to be so easy. But the thing is, I'm sort of a different writer now than I was then. Like, even as I was reading this excerpt to you just now, it's not that I'm not proud of it. And like, I'm aware it's the best I could do. But there are parts in my head I was like, oh, but I could have tightened this. Or I should have done this instead. Or I should have taken this paragraph and done that. Even as I was reading it to you. And like, so I have to sort of make book two feel like it matches book one, even though I'm not where I was as a writer when I wrote book one. So that's been kind of like, in some ways, you're sort of reverting back to your older writing self while also keeping all the things you've learned as a newer writer. So all that, the long-winded answer of saying writing a sequel is very hard. It's very hard.
Oh, I am sure. And for those of you who couldn't see it, this is the absolutely beautiful cover of your second book that's coming out next year. Very excited for it. It's hard to see on the Zoom background, but they are almost holding hands. And I know there was a small section of Twitter that was freaking out because they were almost holding hands and I was freaking out with them. But so we've gotten some questions about how much of this magic system that you created in this world is you entirely and you making it up, and how much of it was directly inspired by West African folklore, and what was it directly taken from folklore? And one person is also saying that they're currently writing a novel inspired by Chinese and Japanese mythology. And so if you have any advice on how you used mythology that's already in existence to create a new one, how would you give advice for people who are trying to do the same thing but for their own mythologies?
So within Wraiths, sort of within the magic system, so and among the Akan people of Ghana, that's my mother's tribe, there's this sort of tradition, the idea that the day of the week on which you're born has great importance, like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, like the weekday has great importance, to the point where we have the tradition called the day name system, where like one of the names a child can be given is related to the day of the week on which they're born. So to give an example, I was born on Saturday. My day name is Ama. And this is seen as something like that has great importance, that you can tell a lot about a person based on the day of the week. Each day has sort of different traits and things associated with them. It's very similar to the Western Zodiac. And this is something I knew very well. So I thought to myself, what if in this world, the day of the week has power, but like it has literal power in the sense that in this world, the type of magic you have depends on the day of the week on which you're born. So that's why in the extra I just read, Malik mentions life day several times, because in that world, he was born on life day. This idea that your closest people to you are not just necessarily your family, but the people who share your same day, like across like ages and across generations, like that day itself ties you all together. And in this world, it literally does, because it governs your magic. So for me, it was very important to me. I wanted to keep the spirit and like sort of the ideas of these beliefs and these traditions, especially because in so many African spiritual traditions, like the fantastic occurs within them. Like the idea of, for many African cultures, of separating magic and religion cannot be done. So really putting the magic in a religious framework in the book was just the most natural way to do it for me. But on that same note, knowing that I wanted to put this in a religious framework so it would be true to the cultures, I also had to understand that like these are religions that actually govern people's lives. This is what they believe. So one question I get a lot is like, oh, where can I learn more about the gods in the book? And I'm like, nowhere, because I made them up. Because even though the traditions are inspired by real traditions and the sort of way people view divinity and the way they view the world and generations, the gods themselves are made up gods, because I didn't want to use real gods and fictionalize them, because to me that felt sort of disrespectful to the actual belief system. Like it felt like taking Jesus and being like, yeah, this dude's fake, which I know some people do that, but personally I like to like respect different people's beliefs like across religions and respect what people choose to find sacred. And so I guess my biggest advice then when dealing with mythology is making sure you have a solid understanding of how the mythologies affect and impact the actual people living through them, and what you can kind of bend and what should be kind of left alone, and like it's too important to touch and it's too important to fictionalize, and what can be sort of made an homage to. Like the idea that people believe in gods, that's universal across human cultures. Like that's not something like putting fake gods in your book, no one's gonna get upset about that. But putting a real god that people believe in, that people sort of like really take a strong core of their identity to, and that means a lot to people, and fictionalizing and treating them like they're just any other random character, that is something that can be very disrespectful and that can cause a lot of harm. And so I never say, oh, don't do X, Y, Z, because writing exists to sort of challenge norms and do all these things and like push boundaries. But if you're gonna push boundaries like that, make sure you're doing it intentionally, and make sure you're doing it with a great understanding of what you're working with and where you're coming from, and be ready to receive pushback if you do it wrong. Be ready to receive pushback like, hey, this is a cultural tradition to me. I feel like it was not portrayed correctly here, and I feel like it's very harmful, disrespectful, the way you put into your writing, and be willing to contend with that. Because if you're going to take credit for like what you do well, you have to be ready to take credit for what you have not done as well. And it's a very humbling process. It can be very upsetting because no one wants to think what they're doing is doing harm. But like, that is the reality of when you're drawing from like real world, especially when you're drawing from marginalized groups who have historically had their cultures and their people sort of misrepresented in fiction. Like, there is a lot more at stake than if you're just taking like the Greek gods, the Greek ancient Greeks. No one is out here actually worshiping Zeus. That's why you can do whatever you want, but like people actually are out here like worshiping these other sort of minority religions that we don't hear as much about. So
yeah. Oh goodness, you're just saying all of these things and I'm just here sitting nodding my head to everything you're saying, because it's all just great. So that actually brings me to another thing. So part of the one of the projects you're currently working on, now that you've submitted the latest draft of A Psalm of Storms and Silence, is your novel for Rick Riordan. So we did get a question in the Q&A, if you have met Rick Riordan now that you are in his imprint, But also if you can talk a little bit about like what that means, because I think that ties in really well with what you were just talking about too.
Yes, okay. Sorry, Jackie, I missed the last part of your question because I think your mic suddenly muted.
I was just, sorry about that. Yeah, just if you can talk a little bit about what it's like being in the imprint and what the imprint is okay. meant to do, because I think it ties in really well with what you were talking about.
Okay. So just for those of you know, you guys know Rick Riordan, author of Percy Jackson. So Rick Riordan, basically Disney approached him. They're like, hey, you know what you did with Greek gods? We want you to do this with other cultures. And he's like, so I'm an old white guy. I probably should not be out here writing books about like Indian gods. Like that doesn't seem okay. But what I can do then is I want to help sponsor writers from these backgrounds to sort of write about their cultures and write about their myths in a way that is true to them and true to their people. And I want to use sort of my name to sort of like help promote it. So they created Rick Riordan Presents, which is an imprint under the Disney Books umbrella. And an imprint is just kind of a trade name within a book, like within a big book publisher, which they can use to kind of denote which books are being published by which staffs. And sort of like, this is our imprint that does our like picture books. This is our imprint that does our like thrillers, like that way. So Rick Riordan Presents only does books that have been picked by Rick himself. And each one follows a similar theme to Percy Jackson. Like, what if X culture's gods were real? So for me, it's, I'm from Ghana, Ghanaian gods, Ghanaian like mythology. I'm like, what if? So the quick elevator pitch is, it's called Sirwa Blatting's Guide to Vampire Hunting. And in Ghana, we have this creature called an Aze, which is like a type of vampire that instead of turning into a bat, it turns into a firefly. And it sucks people's blood, but it can also take over their minds. And so you can be possessed by one and like, no one would ever know, and it would bring misfortune upon everyone around you. So my main character, Sirwa, her and her family come from a long line of people who've been gifted power by the gods to like hunt creatures of black magic like the Aze and witches and all that. Except one day her parents, one of the vampires attacks her house and destroys it, and her parents are like, this is too dangerous, we cannot do this anymore, you are at risk, you need to get out of the vampire hunting life, no. So against her will, she's forced to move to Maryland and live with her normal human aunt and like go to normal school for the first time. And she hates it. She does not like imagine taking Buffy and putting her in like the most boring high school ever. It's very bad. And so she's adjusting to life as a normal girl when she finds out that vampires, the Aze, have actually infiltrated her school and they've actually taken over the teachers' minds. And like, so it's kind of this kids versus the students. And no, it's the students versus the teachers. And like, they don't know this and like no one believes her, and so it's kind of her job to kind of turn her normal classmates into like vampire hunting machines and kind of keep them all safe while also sort of navigating her dual life on kind of what it means to her. And so this book for me, it's been, I get to talk about sort of the black immigrant experience and like growing up in a predominantly white space. I grew up here in UMD in Howard County. Like I navigating a mostly white space and like kind of being that fish out of water in a literal sense and also in a magic sense. She's someone who knows the magic world very well but does not know the human world, because especially in middle grade we see a lot like the sort of normal human kid gets thrust into a magic world with magic powers. So I kind of want to flip that, so it's like magic kid from the magic world is stuck in normal human world. It sucks. So that's kind of my book. It's coming May 2022 and I'm currently working on the first draft now. And I think sort of what is so great about the Rick Riordan Presents imprint is that he knows that like he is an author who has obviously worked very hard in his career and he's had a huge impact on publishing. And so when he puts his name behind the book, like, yo, this is a book that like I have personally selected to like bring to you, to like readers of your book, like people listen. And I think that's something that's been talked about a lot, like what can be done to help marginalized writers actually get their books out there and really convince people that like, hey, just because this book features like an all black cast or an all Latino cast or like XYZ, it does not mean it's not for you, because there's always been this big, in publishing, there was for a long time, people believe like, oh, black readers will only read books about black people, or like white people will not read, if you put a black girl on the cover, you won't read, they won't read that book. Up until like 5-ish years ago, there was actually a big controversy where characters, books would have black main characters, and then they would put white people on the cover to get more people to buy it, even though the character inside the book was black. And so like they whitewashed the book. And it was a big thing like to convince publishers, hey, this is actually bad, do not do this. And so seeing someone with as much like sort of influence in the industry as Rick go, I'm going to take these books, I'm going to elevate them, I'm going to use my name, has been just such, it's just been so wonderful to see, and to see a man using his privilege to really help sort of like authors get their foot in the door and really get their work put out there. The title is Serwa Boateng's Guide to Vampire Hunting. There aren't any links yet to pre-order because it's a little bit early, and I'm also not done. But and so Rick Riordan, have I met him? I've only met him virtually. We did a panel together for his last book tour. Me and the other RRP authors were all on an event with him together. He's very, very nice, very sweet dude, super great. It's so crazy for me because, like, I read Percy Jackson growing up. Like, I had the Scholastic Book Fair edition of Percy Jackson, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like, I am now talking to you, like, as a peer. Like, this is ridiculous. So, yeah, my experience so far has been really great.
That's amazing. As everything else that you have been doing, that's amazing. I'm so excited for the book. And it sounds like a lot of other people are too. So one of the other questions that we've been getting in the Q&A box is about just the publishing everything to do with how you get a book published. And people are specifically curious about pitch wars. I know Celia's in the chat asking about pitch wars, and also about like getting your second book published, and how you even got into the imprint, and what is that process like, and query letters. There are so many questions about publishing, and I know that was a lot, so feel free to only answer a few of those.
Okay, let me try and break this down bit by bit. Let me start with pitch wars. So like I said, pitch wars, they run it once a year, and it's literally what I described. It's only for people who don't have a literary agent yet. So you're unagented, you have your manuscript has to be done. You have to have a fully finished manuscript. So you can't enter with just an idea. Like, you have to have a book. It doesn't have to be perfect, but it has to be done. And you submit it to different mentors, and like the mentors, they post on their blogs like kind of what books they're looking for and what they're interested in. I'm kind of a special case in that I didn't actually submit to the mentor who chose me. I submit to four different ones based on their taste, some books they liked. But the mentor who ended up picking me, Laura, she heard about my book from other mentors, and she's like, wait, that sounds like something I want. Can y'all send it to me? And so they were actually sent to her behind the scenes. So the mentors can swap, but it's not very common. It's very much encourage you research the mentors, you research their taste. And she read my book. She's like, oh my God, I want to work with Rosie. I want this one. So your mentor picks you. And then the window has changed over the years. It's been 2 months, 4 months, down to 3 months. My time I did it, it was a 2 month window. For 2 months, she gave me like an edit letter. And like, she gave me like notes and revisions. Like, we talked on the phone. She's like, okay, I think you need to focus on this element of the book here. I think Malik's motivation's not doing too well here, blah, 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 blah. And like, these are real deep revisions, because the whole idea is to get you prepared for being on a publishing schedule for like when big demands are made of you of your book in a very short time. Like, being asked to rewrite your book in 2 months is not fun. I won't lie, but it's also very realistic timeline for a publishing schedule. And so for 2 months, I'm working back and forth with Laura. I'm working on my book. I'm overhauling. And I also get to ask her questions about her publishing experience, because she was also, she was the author of The Last Eight, which is a sci-fi YA book. And like, how she did all that, and she helped me write my query letter. I can go more into query letters a bit, but basically a query letter is kind of a cover letter for your book. And it's what you send out to agents. Like, hey, I wrote a book about XYZ. I think you'd like it because XYZ. Do you want to be my professional representation to publishers? So she helped me with my query letter and helped me get that all nice and tight and juicy. And all this. And then pitch wars, at the end of the mentorship window, there's what's called the agent showcase. So on the pitch wars website, they put the first page of your book, they put a little pitch that you and your mentor come up with, and then of course the biographical material, like what your book is, like is it YA, is it what genre, blah, blah, blah. And then agents can request to see the full manuscript. So when I did it, I got 23 agent requests. So that was 23 agents who were like, we love this first page, we love this pitch, like we wanna see more of the book. And of those 23, two people ended up offering representation. And of those two, I wound up going with Curiosa. So what Pitch Wars does is it's a very accelerated version of sort of your traditional querying process. Because the thing is, everything you do in Pitch Wars, you can technically do outside Pitch Wars. Like, you can keep revising your book and you can write about query letters and like you can do all that on your own. And there's lots of resources online to do that. But Pitch Wars sort of really guides you in a way, and having a mentor you can bounce off of and like someone who you can run ideas by. And all that. And so that's Pitch Wars. I know right now, the Pitch Wars mentees for this year were actually just announced like a couple weeks ago. So like the people for this year have been picked. So right now they're in the mentorship window when like they're working with their mentors, but the agent showcase hasn't happened yet. So the window to submit's not gonna be till like next summer. Don't quote me on that, but it's not gonna be till next year because this window's already closed this year. But yeah, they happen every year without fail. And a couple books that have come out Pitch Wars, y'all know Children, Blood and Bone, Tomi Adeyemi. The Kiss Quotient, Helen Hong, Cara Vaughn, lots and lots of books have come out, and lots of authors have gotten great success from it, because it's just very much a way to, like, even more than just getting in front of agents, even though that is very exciting, just understanding how to approach your book from a publishing mindset, which I think is something a lot of people have a hard time figuring out how to do. Because, like, there are certain ways that a book needs to be changed to be sort of commercially viable. Like, all forms of writing are valid, don't get me wrong. But there's still a very big difference between, like, a book you write just sort of, like, your own eyes, and, like, you can kind of just do whatever you want, versus a book, like, that has to be, like, on a shelf and has to be readable and people have to understand what you're saying. And so sort of learning those tips and techniques was the best part. So as for query letters, so the thing about query...
Hey, Rosie, I'm sorry. I think we're having some technical issues. I don't know if we caught most of that answer so far, but it seems like you're back.
I'm back. What was the last thing you heard? I'm so sorry.
I think it was at the beginning of your talking about query letters.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I am so sorry. I don't know what happened.
You're good. The Batman background is worth it.
I like it. Okay, now you all get to see a drab office. Okay. But so query letters. Let me start again. The mistake I think a lot of people make with query letters is that they think that a query letter is where they kind of show off their writing. And that's not true. Your query letter is actually, it's a business document. It's where you show the agent that you know where your book fits within the market and that you know how to market yourself, you know how to publish. Because, like, your pages are actually where you, like, show off who you are as a writer. Because book, that's what it's for. But your query letter is market. If you feel this category, like, you want to represent it. The same way a letter tells a business thing, oh, an agent just needs to love my work. And I'm like, the thing is, an agent can love your work, but can they sell your work? And, like, that is a very big distinction. And so it's so important to always, and I think this is where a lot of people kind of have a hard time doing that pivot, is that when you're writing for, like, with the intent of publication, you always have to kind of be aware writing is a business, and that I don't like to call it selling out, because I don't feel like I've sold out, even though I have definitely made some choices for the sake of making the book have a broader appeal. And it comes back to the idea when I talked about nothing is sacred except the stuff that is. Like, I didn't sacrifice any of the stuff I felt was most important to the book. Like, I didn't sacrifice, I knew I wanted all black cast. I didn't care if some people said, oh, some white people might not read it if there's an all black cast. I'm like, I don't care, that's their problem. I didn't sacrifice, like, the main characters, the importance of the setting. I was like, this is gonna be take place in a world based on Africa. I'm not making, like, a European book. Like, it's understanding certain areas where you have to be like, no, I'm putting my foot down. But also understanding if it's anything that's not in your core, like, this is what makes the book, you gotta be ready to let it go. And so it's very important to understand how to look at your own work as a product. And it can be very hard. Like, one thing I've learned is the sort of advice, kill your darlings. I always thought it meant kill your favorite characters. But no, it really means, like, kill the things that you care most about. Like, sometimes there'll be a whole passage that I love, that I'm like, this passage is so good, this is my best writing, but it's like, Rosie, this is like 4 pages, Malik just talked about how sad he is. But I'm like, but he's saying it so beautifully, but it's like, it doesn't matter, it has to go. And it doesn't mean it was bad writing, but it's just, there's no place for that in, like, an action fantasy novel. Like, you can't have that much introspection and that much space, you know? So things like that, like, some of my favorite scenes of the book aren't in the book just because they weren't bad, but they just, they didn't have a place. And being able to make calls like that can be kind of difficult if you're still seeing your book as, like, my baby, it's me bleeding all over the page, it's, like, my rawest emotional form, which I still have a hard time with. I definitely always have, like, no, I can't cut it, and then later on I'm like, yeah, I should cut it. So I definitely think when it comes to query letters, I definitely, there's very much a template you can follow, which is similar to a cover letter. Like, there's a very specific order, which is, like, pitch, heart of the book, sort of your biographical information, and why the agent should sign with you. And I can send you a link to that, Jackie, that you can share with your students if anyone's interested. But it's very much, it's a lot of people try and innovate at the query and try and do crazy things, and it's like, that's not the space to do that. That's the space to sell yourself as a business partner your agent will want to work with. So that's kind of my spiel on queries.
Yeah, oh my God. That's like the most I've ever learned about queries in one sitting. Amazing. So that actually does circle back to a question that we got earlier in the evening, which is if you wrote any scenes that you loved that you had to cut. And I know you were on Twitter earlier this week or last week, and you were talking about how you're a chronic rewriter and that those scenes, like you chronically go back and rewrite new scenes and then they get cut and all of these other things and how that goes into world building. And I don't know if you just have anything you want to talk about that and like any scenes that you were like, oh, this is still canon, it's just not in the book.
There's not so much scenes as much as concepts and characters. Like, for example, Karina had this hot bodyguard character. I loved this boy. I love this. I'm a big fan of, like, the princess and the bodyguard trope. It's one of my favorite romance tropes. And, like, he had to be cut because he was making Malik look bad because Malik's the main love interest. So a character who is more chemistry than her could not be in the book, so he had to go. But I just love that. I love that bodyguard so much. But it definitely... I tend to just rewrite because, like, when the direction of the book is changing, you have so many books, scenes that are, like, good scenes. They're written well, but they just don't match new direction. And the new idea that, like, it's just, oh, gosh. I'm trying to think now because there's so many. At one point, there was, like, this rebel group that Malik teamed up with, but then they had to go because, like, having Malik have too much help was kind of undermining his journey. Like, a big part of the story was the fact that he had to figure this out by himself. And a couple people help him, but, like, when he had this whole group of people helping him, it was sort of undermining his win because it's like, you didn't do this yourself. You had all these people helping you. Those were a whole bunch of characters who I really loved. I had all these backstories for. I'm like, this is how they end up here. This is why they're helping him. But I'm like, they had to go because at the end of the day, as much as I love them, Malik's journey and his emotional story was more important than they were. So that's a choice that had to be made to sacrifice for the core story, which was this young boy going from like unsure of himself, anxious to like a confident sort of leader who could do things and make the choices that need to be made. So it's stuff like that, like concepts that are super cool and ideas that are super great and that could work in a different book, but being real with yourself that sometimes just because it could work does not mean it is working for the story you are telling.
Yeah, oh man, all about the hot bodyguard. Would love to read that draft. So one of the things that you've also been asked in the Q&A is how do you choose what to write next? Because you have all of these projects that you're working on, and I didn't even mention the Shuri Black Panther YA comic book series that like I'm super hyped for. But you have so many things that you're working on that are so exciting. So like, how do you choose like what narrative are you going to try to write next?
Okay, so my next project, the thing is with the Shuri Black Panther one. That one was like a pitch, like basically an editor went to my agent. She's like, hey, we're starting this young reader line featuring like iconic Marvel characters. We're looking for like a Black writer to write a story about young Black Panther. Do you have anyone you should pitch? And my agent's like, wow, I have someone great to pitch. That's why choosing your agent's also super important. Like you want the agents who are like in with industry, who are aware of when like houses are doing stuff like this. And like, that's, I always tell people no agent is better than a bad agent because you're better off with just not having an agent yet than like someone who is just wasting your time, who is not tapped into the industry, who doesn't know stuff like that. So my agent heard about that. She's like, Rosie, Marvel's doing this. I think you should audition. I was like, yeah, I should audition. So I auditioned, I got it, and now I'm working on that. That should be out 2022 as well. But so that's how that, so that was not something that like I technically had in my head as much as like an opportunity presented itself and I jumped on it. As for the Rick Riordan book is actually kind of similar. The editor, Rick Riordan, they're always looking for like new things. They had kind of like run to the end of their like line of books they had ready to go. And they're like, we need to start fleshing out 2022, 2023. And so she's talking to my agent. She's like, hey, we're looking for new authors to pitch us. Like, do you have clients with ideas ready? And Curious was like, Rosie, do you want to pitch Rick Riordan? I'm like, yes, I want to pitch Rick Riordan. And I've had the idea of like a book for young readers set in Ghanaian folklore for a while. And I was just like, so it took me, I spent like about a month or so fleshing out the idea and really getting a proposal together, getting the first 17,000 words together for us to send to them. And they were like, yes, we want to see this. So that was another example where sort of like the opportunity came and I sort of jumped. But so when you're in a different situation, when it's not necessarily an opportunity there, you kind of have to pick. And that's actually something I'm about to be dealing with, not right now, but kind of in the nearish future, which is basically like in many contracts, you have what's called an option book. And basically what your option is that the publisher you are at has first right to see your next work in whatever genre your contract states. So for some people, their option is a wide option, which means your publisher gets to see the next thing you publish first, no matter what genre it's in. So if you published a middle grade, but your next book is an adult horror, your publisher gets to see it first, no matter what. For me, my options only YA fantasy. So my next YA fantasy, HarperCollins, gets first crack at it, which is why we were able to sell the book to Rick Rowden, because it's a middle grade, so it's a different category. But so that means the next time I write a YA fantasy book, I have to send it to my editor first, and she gets the first chance to offer on it and look at it before I can send to any other editors. Like, hey, I wrote this. Who's interested in it? And so this can be good or bad, depending on how your relationship with your house is, how your relationship with your editor is. Like, if you're with a house you don't want to be published with, like, having to go through their process before you can send it to anyone else, that can stink. Versus, like, if you're someone who you really want to stay at your house, you really feel like they're growing you in your career and they understand your vision, then having that option can be a godsend, because it can be, like, you can really tailor it to, like, I know this is what this house is looking for right now, and you guys are right now the only people seeing it. Like, this is how this book is, like, what you want. And so it's basically time to figure out, like, what is next for me in YA, what, like, they want to see. And my editor, we gel really well. She's even told me, like, if you have a hard time picking what idea to present as an option, like, let me know. I can give, like, a couple pointers, like, what we're looking for and all that stuff, and give you an idea to work off, which is really great. But picking ideas, it's definitely a mix of, like, what I personally care about, what I want to write about, and also realities that, like, the market is ready for certain books at certain times. Like, I never like to say anything ever goes out of style, because people said vampires were dead and vampires are back now. So stuff cycles in and out, but you're definitely going to have a harder time with certain books at certain time periods for a variety of reasons, some of which have nothing to do with how good your book actually is. So, like, one of the things that's having a hard time right now, dystopia. I want to write a dystopia book right now. No one could stop me. No one could be like, no, don't do that. But I also have to deal with the reality that, like, not as many editors are into dystopia. The editors who are into it, dystopia, the advances aren't as high. You're not going to get as much marketing. You're not going to get as much push for it. You're not going to get as much support in-house. And so you're always kind of balancing between writing books you generally care about that you want to see out there, and books that are also going to support, that are going to further your career, that is going to have the team at the house excited, and, like, they want to push this book, and this is the book that they're sending to their accounts, and that they're sending to the conferences, and they're sending out there for people to see. And so where that line is, I think it's different for everyone, and this is also where a good agent's helpful, because a good agent will be real with you, like, the market is not buying vampire books, or, yes, rom-coms are in right now, if you have a rom-com idea, let's take it out, like, this is what people want. And that's why it's so important to, like, pick your agent carefully, because, like, if you're just any old person, they'll be like, yeah, sure, why don't we just send the publishers the 900th magic school idea they've seen? Because, like, trust me, y'all, just word of advice, if you have a magic school idea, make sure it is dope as hell, because every single editor has gotten 800, this is the next Hogwarts ideas, and they are sick of it. So, like, because every year someone thinks, I have the next magic school that hasn't been done, and it's very hard to do magic school when, like, it's just, be careful with the magic school book, because, like, make sure it is good as hell.
Yeah, all right, so we are starting to run out of time, so we only have time for, like, maybe one or two more questions. One really quick question that we did get was, does Pitch Wars cost money?
No, it's free.
That's pretty good. That's good to know. All mm-hmm. right. And then one question that we did get was, one person saying that they're finding writing less enjoyable because it's discouraging to see so many other people around their age and younger doing so much better at it and finding success where they are not. So what advice can you give on not giving up on writing when it feels like maybe you should, or maybe you feel like you have to?
So the thing about writing, and I think that's so valid, but the sad reality is there are so many careers out there where you're going to get more immediate recognition for your time, a very clear return on investment very quickly. You're gonna see, writing is one of those things, like, a lot of the work you do on the back end doesn't actually get seen when you're done on it. Like, even with Wraiths, this book is like 100,000 words long, and there exist close to 600,000 words that aren't in the book. That's, I still wrote 700,000 words worth of book, but only 100,000 words got published. Like, and all that, to go back to your question, this idea that other people are gonna be doing better than you, other people are gonna be doing all this stuff, and it feels discouraging. At the end of the day, the thing that makes you want to write has to be bigger than the thing that makes you not want to write. Like, at the end of the day, it has to be that. Because you're right, there are so many other things you could do besides writing. But, like, writing, for every writer I know, even the ones who are most discouraged, who have a book flop or have a have bad critical reception, or like they have one book do great, then the next book is awful, or their agent leaves them, or their editor leaves them, or all of the 18 million things that can happen, even once you get past your foot in the door. There's this idea like, once I get my agent, it's going to be great. Once I get my publisher, it's going to be great. Once I have the first book, I'll be great. And I have friends at every level of the publishing thing, and every one of them has had to deal with some kind of setback, some kind of thing that you just cannot see from the outside. So, and putting up with all that, it's a lot. And it's a lot, especially for like an industry which is also tied so deeply to your own emotional state and takes so much creativity and sort of mental time and physical time out of you. But the thing that makes you want to write has to be stronger than like the rest of that. Like, and that does not necessarily mean you have to love writing every second. It doesn't mean you have to feel great. It doesn't mean you have to be like, oh wow, getting rejections is great, I love this. But you, the thing that makes it worth writing, the thing that makes you be like, man, that rejection sucked, let me send one more query letter. Or man, that edit didn't hit it, let me just do one more edit. Like that has to be stronger than the rest of it. Because if it's not this industry and this like pastime and this like career, it will eat you alive. And it will, and there's nothing wrong with writing just because writing is what you, it just makes you happy and it makes you as a person happy. This is why I'm always specifying like writing for publication. It's like you have to like find the place and find that within you, what makes it worth keep going. Because the thing is, people are always going to be younger than you coming out. People are always going to sell their book for more. People are always going to get more buzz. They're going to get more critical reviews. They're going to get a bigger, I had one author friend who was complaining because the movie of her book did worse than another person's movie. And I'm just like, your book was turned into a movie. To me, that is just ridiculous. And yet even when she's at that level, she's still like, oh, but she didn't sell as many tickets as that author. Like no matter where you are, you're not going to be happy because there's always somewhere else you could be. Like unless you're like Jane Austen, in which case you are dead but happy, I guess. But no matter where you are, and so if you're letting where other people are kind of dictate how you feel about where, like what you're doing, you're going to be miserable the entire way in this process. So I say start there. Like you have to want it so much that it makes the bullshit worth it.
I think, yeah, a bunch of us are clapping for you because that was some truth right there. And we are winding down now, but we just want to say thank you so much. Your time and your wisdom and your books have brought so much joy. I am so excited. I'm just going to go ahead and pop in the chat the HarperCollins pre-order link if anybody else is so moved to pre-order your next book, because I know I already have. Thank you so much, Rosie Brown. You are outstanding. You are truly a wonderful human being, and I love you so much. Jonna, do you want to go ahead?
Sure. So thanks everyone for coming, and please stay in touch, stay safe, stay warm tonight, and we'll see you next semester for more events. So good night, and thank you.